people give up and say, well, you know, in this world we are never going to be able to achieve peace. The problem there is that over generations we have created a culture of violence. Everything about us is violently motivated. Our language has become violent, our behaviors have become violent, our relationships with each other have become violent. Everything is violent. And that's the glass house that I'm talking about. And if we subscribe to violence in every action that we do every day, even bringing up our children is violent. And that's how we perpetuate this whole culture of violence. So we have to change that culture of violence to a culture of non-violence if we want to work for peace and if we want to really attain peace. So I want to share with you what my grandfather taught me about violence, because it's the only way we can understand non-violence is by first understanding what we mean by violence. And unfortunately, all of us have a very limited understanding of violence, because we look at violence only in the physical form, when wars break out or when people kill each other in the streets and you know, that kind of physical manifestation of violence, then we, you know, suddenly get up and say, well, there's a lot of violence there. But my grandfather taught me that we do a lot of physical and non-physical violence, and that is what we need to address ourselves to. And this happened one day when I was, you know, a little boy. I was 12 years old, coming back from school, and I had a notebook and a pencil in my hand. And the pencil was about 3 inches long. And I thought to myself, I deserve a better pencil. This is too small for me to use. So without a second thought, I threw the pencil away. And that evening when I met grandfather and asked him for a new pencil, instead of giving me one, he subjected me to a lot of questions. He wanted to know what happened to the pencil I had in the morning and how did it become small and where did I throw it away and on and on and on. And I couldn't understand why he was making such a fuss over a little pencil until he told me to go out and look for it. And I said, you must be joking. I said, you don't expect me to go out and look for a pencil in the dark? It's already getting dark outside. And he said, oh yes, I do. He has a flashlight. And he gave me a flashlight and sent me out to look for that pencil. And I must have spent about 2 hours searching for it. And when I finally found it and brought it to him, he said, now I want you to sit here and learn 2 very important lessons. The first lesson is that even in the making of a simple thing like a pencil, we use a lot of the world's natural resources. And when we throw them away, we are throwing away the world's natural resources, and that is violence against nature. And the second lesson is that because in an affluent society, we can afford to buy all these things in bulk, we overconsume the resources of the world, and because we overconsume them, we are depriving people elsewhere of these resources and they have to live in poverty, and that is violence against humanity. And that was the first time I realized that all of these little things that we do every day, consciously and unconsciously, all of that add to the violence that we have created in the world. And all of us do that all the time. You know, if you examine your lives, you will find we waste so many resources. We overconsume so many resources because we can afford it. And all the time, every time we overconsume and waste things, we are contributing to the violence in society. So that's what he meant by understanding violence. To drive home this lesson, he made me draw a family tree of violence, a genealogical tree. On the same principles as we do a family tree, you know, with a grandfather and then the sibling and the sons and daughters and then the rest of the family, and it, the tree keeps growing. But in the same way, he made me draw a tree of violence, with violence as the grandparent. And every day, before I went to bed, I had to examine everything that I had experienced and things that I may have seen or observed or read about. All of this had to be analyzed and put in their appropriate places on that tree. There was passive violence on one side and physical violence on the other side. Now, physical violence is all the kinds of violence where we use physical force against one another. All the wars and killings and beatings and murders and rape and all of these things that we do where we use physical force is physical violence. But the passive violence is things that we do to people where we don't use any physical force and yet we hurt people. It's like discrimination, oppression, looking down on people, teasing people, calling them names, and you know, racial discrimination and color discrimination and wasting resources and thousands of things that we do every day, consciously and unconsciously. All of that is passive violence. And when I began to do this form of introspection, within a few months, I was able to fill up a whole wall in my room with acts of passive violence. And that's when I became aware of how much passive violence I was committing. And once I became aware of that, then grandfather told me the link between the two. He said that we commit passive violence all the time, every day, consciously and unconsciously, and that generates anger in the victim. And the victim then resorts to physical violence to get justice. So it is passive violence that fuels the fire of physical violence. So logically, if we want to put out that fire of physical violence, we have to put out, cut off the fuel supply. And since the fuel supply comes from each one of us, we have to become the change that we wish to see in the world. We have to create peace within ourselves, create peace around us, in our families, and from that peace will radiate outside. So it has to begin with us. We have to do that introspection. We have to find out how do we contribute to violence in the world, and how can we change ourselves so that we don't contribute any more violence. And that is the primary thing. The second thing, and as I said, you know, passive violence generates anger, and anger results into physical violence. And that happens because we have not been ever taught how to deal with our anger. We just allow each person to find their own way of dealing with anger. And all of us end up abusing anger. Now, I was in that situation when I was growing up in South Africa as a young boy. Became a victim of prejudices, and I was beaten up by whites, and then I was beaten by Africans, and I was filled with so much rage that I wanted eye for an eye justice. And it was an obsession with me. And that's what happens, you know. Today we all are told constantly that you've got to make somebody pay for what has happened to you. And that's when my parents took me to India and I lived with grandfather, and the first lesson that grandfather taught me was about understanding that anger and being able to channel anger into positive action. He said that anger is like electricity. It's just as useful and just as powerful as electricity is, but only if we use it intelligently. But it can be just as deadly and destructive if we abuse it. So just as we channel electrical energy and bring it into our lives and use it for the good of humanity, we must learn to channel anger in the same way so that we can use that energy for the good of humanity rather than abuse the energy and cause death and destruction. And he taught me how to do this. You know, we are conditioned because of that culture of violence to act immediately. We become angry and we just explode. and we do things and say things that we regret later on. We've got to be able to take time out and get control of our minds when we get angry. And for this, he taught me several lessons that I had to do to be able to gain control of my mind there. You know, we are very conscious about our physical appearance, and so we are constantly doing physical exercises because we want a healthy body. But we don't ever do any mental exercises to have a healthy mind there. And that is what we need to do. He made me sit in a room quietly every day for a few minutes with a flower in front of me. And I had to concentrate for a full minute. All my mental faculties had to be concentrated on that flower. And then I had to close my eyes and see for how long I could keep that image in my mind's eye. In the beginning, I found that the moment I closed my eyes, the image vanished. But when I began to do this exercise regularly every day, I found that I could keep that image longer and longer in my mind's eye. And to that extent, I was getting control over my mind, that I was being able to focus my mind on what I wanted it to focus on. And that's a very important exercise that all of us need to do, apart from keeping an anger journal. You know, it's very helpful to keep an anger journal, but that journal has to be written positively. You have to write the anger journal with the intention of finding a solution to the problem, and then commit yourself to finding a solution. You know, it's no use just pouring your anger out into the journal there, because when you go back and read the journal and you are reminded of the incident and you get angry all over again, it doesn't help anybody then. So it's important that you write the journal with the intention of finding a solution. And when you begin to do all these exercises, you'll find that you are able to control your anger and you're able to reduce the violence that you experience within your own life and in the lives of people around you then. And once that happens, then it radiates and eventually the world would also become conscious of it. But the last lesson that I want to share with you is about building relationships, which is a very important aspect of the culture of nonviolence. Today our relationships with each other are based on selfish interests. We are constantly thinking about what am I going to gain from this relationship? And if I don't gain anything from the relationship, why should I bother to cultivate it? And so we have this constant breaking up of relationships. We make relationships and we break them and it just goes on in a cycle. And every time you break a relationship, you're causing conflict. And every conflict that you cause, you're creating a potential for violence. So relationships must be built on the four principles of respect, understanding, acceptance, and appreciation. We have to respect ourselves and respect each other and respect our connection with all of creation. And from that respect we will understand who we are and what we are and why are we here on earth. And once we understand that, then we will be able to appreciate our own humanity. Then we would be able to look at individuals as human beings and not look at them as black, white, yellow, brown, or woman, or man, or all these labels that we have put upon ourselves. Today we have so many labels to identify people that we have forgotten that behind those labels there is a human being. So we've got to remove those labels and begin to look at each other as human beings. And when we are able to do that, then we will be able to create peace in the world and become one with the world. You know, these days, in times of war, we hear a lot about patriotism and being proud of your country and being wanting to do things for your country and all of those things that are talked about, which is fine momentarily. think about it. Can we save this corner of the world if the rest of the world is going down the drain? Can the United States, being a superpower, the only superpower in the world, can it save itself in this corner of the world and allow the rest of the world to go down the tube? We can't. We are going to follow the rest of the world if that's going to happen. So our security, our welfare, our goodwill, everything is connected with the security, welfare, and goodwill of the rest of the world. And what happens to the rest of the world is going to happen to us eventually. So we have to look at the broader picture. We are a part of the world, and we have to understand that. We can't live in isolation. We can't say that I'm an Indian and I'm only concerned about India, and I'm a US citizen and I'm going to be concerned only about US and live in that kind of isolated islands. The world may be made up of islands, but we are, our destinies are interlinked and interconnected, and we have to understand that and appreciate that, and that's when we will be able to truly create peace there.